In part 3 of our lesson on vectors, we will do a geometry and trigonometry review. So first, let's remind ourselves what happens when two parallel lines are cut by a transversal. In this picture, we have line A is going to be parallel to line B, and we would mark that by putting matching chevrons on the lines. When you have parallel lines, the alternate interior angles are congruent to each other. So in our picture, the alternate interior angles would be angle 3 is congruent to angle 5, and also angle 4 is going to be congruent to angle 8. So those are the alternate interior angles. When the lines are parallel, the same side interior angles are supplementary. So same side refers to being on the same side of the transversal. Interior, of course, meaning inside the two parallel lines. So same side interior would be angle 4 and 5, and they're going to be supplementary to each other. So we could say that angle 4 plus angle 5 is going to equal 180 degrees. And it would also be true that angle 3 and angle 8 would add up to be 180 degrees. When you have parallel lines, the corresponding angles end up being congruent to each other. Corresponding means in the same relative position. So angle 1 is going to be congruent to angle 5 because they're both in the upper left. In this group of angles, angle 1 is the upper left, and in the second group of angles, angle 5 is the upper left. So those are corresponding angles, so they will be congruent. Angle 2 will be congruent to angle 8 because they are both the upper right angle. Angle 3 will be congruent to angle 7 because they are both the lower right angles. And finally, angle 4 will be congruent to angle 6 because they're both the lower left angles. Next, let's review what we know to be true about the angles and sides in a parallelogram. We know that the opposite sides of a parallelogram are parallel to each other. So we know side HS would be parallel to side AT, and HA would be parallel to ST. We also have that the opposite sides of a parallelogram are congruent to each other. So HS would equal AT, and HA would equal ST. The opposite angles of a parallelogram are congruent. So angle H is going to be congruent to angle T. Those are opposite angles. Angle S will be congruent to angle A. Those are opposite angles. The consecutive angles in the parallelogram are supplementary. So we've talked about this before. We know angle H and angle A would be supplementary because they're consecutive angles. Also, angle A with angle T would be supplementary. Angle T with angle S would be supplementary, and S with H. So all the pairs of consecutive angles are going to be supplementary. We know that each diagonal divides the parallelogram into congruent triangles. So if we drew in diagonal SA, we would end up with these two triangles being congruent to each other. Or if we drew in diagonal HT, then these two triangles would end up being congruent to each other. And one thing to keep in mind is that the diagonal does not bisect the angle. So when we draw in diagonal SA, it's not going to divide angle S into equal pieces. That's not going to happen. Only in the very special case of a square will that happen. Same if we draw in diagonal HT. It does not cut angle H into two equal parts. So that's very important to keep in mind. Now, a linear pair of angles is in this picture here. A linear pair occurs when you have two adjacent angles whose exterior sides form a line. Now, when that happens, we know that a straight angle has a measure of 180 degrees, so that means these two angles would have to add up to be 180, and angles that add up to be 180 are called supplementary. So when you have a linear pair of angles, they are going to be supplementary. So in this picture, we can say that angle 1 plus angle 2 is going to add up to be 180 degrees. In solving applications of vectors, you will be using triangles all over the place. So let's review the triangle sum theorem. We know that the three angles of a triangle have to add up to be 180 degrees. So in this picture, we know angle A plus angle B plus angle C has to be 180. It can never go over. Another important fact to keep in mind is that every triangle has at least two acute angles. It could have three acute angles, but every triangle will have at least two acute angles. The most it can have of right or obtuse, of course, is one. That becomes important in our triangle solving strategies, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. Now, within a triangle, remember the naming convention. If this is angle A, then its opposite side is lowercase a. Angle B, its opposite side is lowercase b. Angle C, its opposite side is lowercase c. When we're using the law of sines, we know that we have a proportion where the sine of angle A divided by its opposite side, little a, is equal to the sine of angle B divided by its opposite side, little b, is equal to the sine of C divided by its opposite side, little c. The strategy to use when you're working with law of sines is, whenever possible, find the smaller angle first, and you will know it's going to be a smaller angle if it's opposite a shorter side. And the reason you want to find the smaller angle first is because that smaller angle is guaranteed to be acute. Remember that every triangle has at least two acute angles. The most it could have is one right or obtuse. So given the choice between two angles, the smaller one will have to be acute. And the reason that's important is because with the law of sines, you have to watch out for the ambiguous case. And the ambiguous case occurs any time you're using the law of sines with only one known angle. And when that happens, you will have to check for two possible triangles, one possible triangle, or no possible triangles. Another tool we can use to solve triangles is the law of cosines. And we know using the law of cosines, whatever side you get by itself, then on the other end, sort of the bookend, you have its opposite angle. So if you have little a over here, you're going to have capital A over here. If you have little b here, you'll have capital B on the other end. Little c here, capital C on the other end. And then the other two sides fill in. So if little a is here, it's going to be b and c here and here. If little b is here, then it's going to be a and c here and here. If little c is here, then it's going to be a and b here and here. Now the great thing about the law of cosines is it does not have an ambiguous case. So the strategy to use when you're solving a triangle with law of cosines is to find the largest angle first. You will know it's the largest angle because it's opposite the longest side. And law of cosines will tell you right away whether that angle is obtuse or acute. And then, of course, you will know that the smaller two angles absolutely positively have to be acute because every triangle has at least two acute angles. So the biggest angle in a triangle might be obtuse, it might be acute, or it might be right. But for sure, we know that the smaller two angles in a triangle must be acute. Now, in order to use the law of cosines, you have to have the special cases where we have side, 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 meaning we know all three sides, or we have side, angle, side, meaning we have two sides and their included angle.